we're getting married. We don't know when, but inshallah, hopefully in the future, once this pandemic is over and once we're done with college, we'll eventually get married. The next day after meeting her, I gained more knowledge about Islam through her, and I was reading the Quran, and I bought a prayer mat, and I said that I want to pray for the first time. It wasn't the best prayer, but it was a good attempt. So I tried it, put my hands up in the air, Allahu Akbar, God's greatest, and eventually, when I put my forehead onto the ground, which is the full embodiment of submission to Allah, the first thing I said in mind was, God, if you're out there, help me, save me, save me, help me. So when I eventually let my forehead off of the ground, I looked up and started crying. Tears were coming out of my eyes. It's like an emotional hug. That's when I realized that I'm going to be a Muslim. I want to devote my life to God.
Hello, we're with Bailey Reed Bushey, and he converted to Islam around February of 2020. So thank you so much for joining us. How are you this morning?
Alhamdulillah. I woke up, I'm able to breathe, I'm able to experience a new day, and I'm able to experience a new life, you know, and I'm able to be alive, to be with you today, and that's always a blessing. So every day is a good day because of that.
Alhamdulillah, every day is a good day when you can wake up. This side of the dirt, that's what a little old man told me once in the hospital. So alhamdulillah. Was it hard for you to convert?
Yeah, it was very hard around the time when I converted. It's not so much the difficulty of converting, but it's more of the process that kind of brought me up to converting. That was very, very difficult.
So what was the process? What was the process that happened? What was the hard parts of the process? Were there any easy parts?
There were no easy parts. So when I talk about my story of converting or reverting to Islam, it makes me explore a very dark and very bleak time in my life. And long story short, I suffered 6 deaths in my family, and these were family members, and each death happened a month away from each other. So my grandfather passed away. A month later, my grandmother passed away. A month later, my uncle passed away. And a month later, my dog had been put down. It was just a bunch of one after another. Mm-hmm. And I just, for me as a person, I couldn't fully go through the grieving process, because when I think I'm about to go through it, I had to witness another tragedy and just keeps on repeating, you know. But that's the short story of it. The long story, if you want me to talk about, because it's...
Yeah, please do.
It's not quite long, but...
Yeah, I know.
So, I was very close to my grandfather, and to say that... Honestly, to say that we were close is a very understatement. He was like my rock in life, and he was very active in the church. He was a pastor. His whole philosophy in life was he didn't hate people because they weren't Christian. You know, he always taught me that it doesn't matter if anyone's Christian, atheist, Buddhist, or whatever the case may be, Muslim or Jewish, or whatever, wherever they are, you know, everyone comes from a different walk of life, and as long as they are good people and they don't hurt you and they don't cause any disunity and destruction in your life, then they're good people. And he always had a philosophy. His motive in life was to help people, and he started a food drive back at the local church. And because of that food drive, there are many families that didn't go hungry because of that. He fed so many families and whatnot.
Wonderful.
He was very proactive in his church and whatnot. He's sure. a very hard worker. And I think I got that element from him because, mm-hmm. you know, I'm clocking at work, I'm taking people's shifts and whatnot. So more like a guy from him.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Sure.
But eventually he got sick and I can't remember the proper name for it, but it was some kind of bone cancer that he had.
Oh, okay. Sure.
And we didn't know the severity of it, but the severity of it really punched us in the face when he was unable to attend work regularly. That's when we know something was wrong because he's always working.
Sure.
He has a very, very good work motive.
Sure.
So eventually he got weaker and weaker, and to the point where he had to use a cane. Then mm-hmm. he was subject to a wheelchair. And the sad part mm-hmm. was when my aunt was at the hospital with him, he was in a wheelchair, and usually he wants to display his strength by walking and whatnot, but this time he said, I'm too tired, please mm-hmm. help me, mm-hmm. which really hurt her heart, broke her heart and whatnot. So eventually we got to the point where we had to get hospice, and we had to, you know, take care of him. He took care mm-hmm. of us. That's our attempt to take care of him. Like, we had to help him use the restroom, eat, and so on and so forth.
Sure.
So eventually it gets to the point where he got very sick and mm-hmm. he was bedridden. And mm-hmm. that's when we kind of knew that his time was almost up.
Sure.
And I remember my dad woke me up when I was in my room, and he said that, you know, you might want to go ahead and be a grandpa because he's probably not going to make it.
Yeah, sure.
What he wanted to get all of his Bibles, every Bible in the house to surround him.
Okay.
He wanted his family with him, and he could barely talk, and mm-hmm. our extended family from up north, from our Native American tribe reservation, came down, Mattawani mm-hmm. tribe, because mm-hmm. The family on my mom's side is full-blooded Native American.
Mm-hmm.
So we have family from the reservation come down. We also have family from dad's side. So we have family from West Virginia come down.
Sure.
We were all you know, I was taking care of him. My brother was taking care of him. We were just getting water, make sure he's moisturized and, you know, stuff. And, you know, he's not in pain.
Mm-hmm.
So, eventually, the last thing he said to me before he could not talk anymore was, he barely said it, but he said that, you know, I'm proud of you, buddy. This is not goodbye for now. This is not goodbye forever. This is just goodbye for now. At the time, my grandmother was in the hospital. I can't remember why she was in the hospital. But my grandmother was going to be there with him when he passed away. So my brother drove up to the hospital. He was able to bring her home.
Mm-hmm.
And she was in the hospital bed at the house.
Sure.
But when that was going on, my grandfather was holding a picture of him and my grandmother when they were young. He just kept mm-hmm. on looking at that picture. Mm-hmm. Like, he was holding on to that.
Sure.
So eventually, when my grandmother got into the room,
mm-hmm.
she held his hand, and that's when he passed away.
Sure. He was waiting for her.
Yeah.
That can happen sometimes. A lot of times when people are at that point, they'll wait for a certain moment. A certain someone to be in the room with them.
Yeah. And that's kind of made the idea that, you know, my grandfather was going to die with, and that's how he passed away, with his heart in his hand, which is my grandmother.
Alhamdulillah.
Yeah. And a month later, you know, my grandmother started getting sick because obviously mm-hmm. brought her out of the hospital, and there was no guarantee she was going to make it because of that.
Yeah, sure.
So we were getting like hospice and a bunch of other stuff to help her out. And eventually She was in the living room on her own, and I decided to stay with her because even though we didn't talk a whole lot, I was not going to let her be alone on Wednesday.
Yeah, of course not. Yeah.
So there would be times where I'll go outside, and every time I go outside, one thing I notice is this black and blue butterfly, which I've never seen before.
Mm-hmm.
And I've seen many butterflies before. I think we all have. But I've never seen a butterfly with a very distinct color scheme. And there was something about it. Like, every time I got close to it, every time I got close to this butterfly, I felt this strong emotional connection. Like, tears started coming out of my eyes. And everywhere I'd go, I would find this butterfly in the most bizarre, obscure places, like inside the mall, the butterflies there, or when I went to college at the time before I dropped out, and I'm in college now, a different one.
Sure.
This butterfly would be on the campus, inside the campus.
Mm-hmm.
I'll just see this butterfly everywhere I go. That's and there's something particularly interesting about it.
Mm-hmm.
So eventually I got home from college. And my grandmother, it was weird because she was on this bed with this oxygen tank around her nose.
Sure.
And hospice they were. And she was still alive, but she couldn't talk. I've never seen her in that condition. It was very hard to see her one day looking normal. And the next day, she's like all hooked up to medical equipment.
Sure, that could be hard to see.
Yeah. And the next day she passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And I was there when she passed away. And I had to go outside because I needed to be alone.
Sure.
The thing I saw when I went outside was I saw a black and blue butterfly again, but it wasn't one black and blue butterfly. It was two of those. And those two black and blue butterflies flip into the sky, and to this day, I've never seen those butterflies again.
Mm-hmm.
And it made me realize that the black and blue butterfly was my grandfather's spirit waiting for my grandmother so they could finally go to paradise together, which really hits. So, you know, eventually I started, when I was going through all these deaths, I was also in a relationship that was very emotionally neglectful and abusive, which that's a story on its own, which I'm not going to go into. So I started dating this person, and some elements of that relationship kind of plays into the conversion, so I may mention a few aspects of it.
Sure.
But I started dating this person, and, you know, we got close, and, you know, I started going out together.
Mm-hmm.
And everything was fine. Then, you know, she was Greek. I think she was Greek Orthodox Christian, I think is what it's called.
Okay, yeah.
And at the time, I was agnostic. And even as a kid, I had an idea that God was real, but I didn't consider myself a Christian because I just feel like there's no spiritual kind of aspects to it.
Sure.
I'm not saying it's bad, but it wasn't, I couldn't reconnect to it. And, you know, she starts talking about Jesus, God, and so on and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
And I got interested, and I went back to the church that my grandfather preached at. And we were a Baptist family. So I got baptized, and after that happened, you know, I kind of had, that's when things started getting bad.
Mm-hmm.
So I've always been a part of that church.
Sure.
When my grandfather passed away, I've always had friends there, and so on and so forth. So everyone at that church knew who I was.
Sure.
And eventually, when I got baptized, just things start going bad.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I was more stressed out than I've always been. And the person I was dating, She moved to Miami at the time, so became long distance, which, you know, sure. I wasn't upset about that, as long as there was an angle to where we could see each other again. And
sure.
Honestly, I don't like Miami.
Oh, you don't? Yeah.
So I really didn't want to move to Miami, but I was going to just for her. And, mm-hmm. you know, she starts, and this is when the emotional neglect start playing in, which might really get into. So things start getting bad, mm-hmm. and we had my nephew, his name was Alex, he was 4 years old. Now, this is up in West Virginia on my dad's side of the family. Now, I wasn't there when this happened, and I'm thankful that I wasn't there, because this would have broke me.
Sure.
He was 4 years old, and he was playing. I can't remember the full story, but he was playing, and he bumped his head real hard, and passed away.
Yeah.
And I can't imagine the difficulty that my family and West Virginia had to go through experiencing that.
Sure, it's terrible to lose a child.
Yeah, 4 years old.
That's, 4 years is so young. Yeah. And so unexpectedly.
Yeah, exactly. And it's painful. Just go through all this. That happens. Then a month after that, my uncle on my mom's side, he had some kind of, he was also suffering from cancer, but was, he had a bad alcohol problem. Now, he wasn't an alcoholic. He just drank alcohol a lot. Sure. He wasn't abusive or anything. So what happened was, just the years of drinking a lot, it kind of really messed with his internal stomach. And
sure, sure.
He's been sick for a very long time. And in his last days alive, you know, you kind of see him, you know, he just looks a lot more different, just looks very ill, and just, it's very heartbreaking.
Mm-hmm.
So eventually, unexpectedly, he passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And a month after that, the dog we had at the time, it was a corgi.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't remember, but I remember he crawled out, this is what happened, he crawled out from under the bed. His back legs weren't working.
No.
Like, they were just numb.
They were just numb. Yeah, sure.
Yeah. And he had no control of his bowel movement. So, you know, he's urinating and defecating. Yeah, yeah. He had no control over it.
Yeah.
So we took him to the animal hospital, and they gave us some things we can do. We can do a surgery, which would cost, I think it was
$4,000.
Mm-hmm. Or you can do, or even like give him like some kind of wheelchair, just that he had to have someone be home to take him out and whatnot, that would cost a few thousand dollars.
Mm-hmm.
And the other option was that we can put him down, which costs like $100.
Sure.
And I'm very bitter to this day. I'm still bitter about that.
Yeah.
So we didn't have the money. I mean. No one, unless you're super, super rich, you're not going to have $4,000 in your pocket, because they're asking for it up front, and we don't have
it. Yeah, of course. Yeah, they don't.
No one is.
Yeah.
So, eventually, we had to put him down, and
that must have been a difficult decision.
Yeah, yeah, and we had to bury him in the backyard.
Mm-hmm.
And a month later, the emotional abuse got bad. Mm-hmm. The person I was dating,
mm-hmm.
She didn't believe the things that I was going through. And in her words, she didn't believe the emotional BS that I was going through. And
well, that's a lot. I mean, that is a lot in a short period of time. It's a lot of grieving that you have to work through. And grief is work. So, yeah.
And eventually, she started working at this new job. And she told me that she was getting very close to her coworker, and they were exchanging phone numbers and personal stories, and they were going to hang out the next day. Now, at this time, she wouldn't let me go and visit her, because she doesn't want her family knowing about me. I don't know why. So when she told me all that, I thought it was very bizarre and kind of suspicious. Mm. I wasn't like, okay, well, I wasn't going to accuse her of anything because.
Sure.
So, what I told her was, oh, okay, cool. I'm glad you're hanging out with a new friend. How long have you guys been, like, when are you plan hanging out? And she's like, oh, we're just friends, chill out, which, you know, wasn't being aggressive about it.
Yeah.
Which is very weird. Hang on, my cat's trying to get into the room. Give me 1 second.
Oh, that's okay. So, okay.
There we go.
So, this sounds like a lot. You were going through a lot at that time. Yeah. So what about this? Why did you become Muslim? I mean, I can see there was a lot of crisis going on, but why did you become Muslim?
Well, here's when me become Muslim builds up. Mm-hmm. Eventually, a breakup happened. Mm-hmm. And I'm a musician. I like to work on music and art, and I still do this as my way of getting my emotions out. Mm-hmm. So I had a friend who was Muslim. His name is Amin. I think he's Pakistani. He lives in North Carolina.
Sure.
And I kind of learned more about Islam and the fundamentals of it based through him. And one thing he always told me when I asked him how your how's your day so far, it doesn't matter if he's having a good day or a bad day.
Sure.
He tells me, alhamdulillah, every day is a good day. Mm-hmm. Which is such a positive outlook in life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So eventually I wasn't really getting to the church. It didn't feel right. When I go to the church, there are just concepts that didn't make sense, like the Holy Trinity.
Sure, you know, sure.
Which when I entered the church, it was like a rock concert, which is not necessarily a bad thing, but it didn't feel intimate, like when you go to a mosque or a synagogue. Mm-hmm. So one thing they kept on saying was Jesus, 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 Jesus. They never mentioned God, just mm-hmm. Jesus.
Yeah, sure.
Which I'm not saying that Christians are bad people. I just, it felt more like they're worshiping the man and not the creator. They're worshiping the creation, but not the creator.
Yes.
And eventually, I've been doing research on the Bible and hearing things like the gospel according to Matthew, the gospel according to. I'm like,
yeah.
Okay, well, these people weren't alive with Jesus. The gospels were actually written 40, 50 years after Jesus. And there really wasn't any evidence of a crucifixion that really happened. Mm-hmm. And no one knows what happened to Jesus. He just disappeared. So eventually, mm-hmm. I bought the Quran,
okay,
read it, and I opened it to just any random page. The first thing I read was, we did not send this book down onto you to suffer, but as a remembrance of who is worthy of worship, or something like that, mm-hmm. which always stuck to me. And eventually, I was in a very, very dark and scary time of life. I was in a music studio where I was surrounded by synthesizers and instruments and computers. And the studio is in the same room where my grandfather passed away.
Wow.
And I told people that I may not be as talkative for a few hours because I'm going to go and work on music and try to get something out there.
Sure.
But the reality was what I was really trying to do was I was trying to kill myself.
Oh.
And it's very weird seeing how things are now, seeing how things were back then. Mm-hmm. And alhamdulillah, I'm not dead. I'm still alive.
Alhamdulillah.
I was surrounded by a bunch of computer monitors and pills and just instruments and stuff like that. And I was in a trance kind of state where, you know, it's weird. Mm-hmm. Eventually, the day after that, that's when I met my current fiance, Fatima, and kind of started talking, and we're getting married.
Really, that's wonderful. Congratulations.
Thank you. We don't know when, but inshallah, hopefully in the future, once this pandemic is over and once we're done with college, we'll eventually get married. So the next day after meeting her, I gained more knowledge about Islam through her, and I was reading the Quran, and I bought a prayer mat, and I said that I want to pray for the first time, and it wasn't the best prayer, but it was a good attempt.
Yeah, well, I'm a reaver too, so yes, I understand what you mean.
So, you know, I tried it, put my hands up in the air, Allahu Akbar, God's greatest, and eventually, when I put my forehead onto the ground, which is the full embodiment of submission to Allah, the first thing I said in mind was, God, if you're out there, help me, save me, save me, help me. So, when I eventually let my forehead off of the ground, I looked up and started crying. Tears were coming out of my eyes. It's like an emotional hug, but if that makes any sense.
No, that makes sense. Yeah. You really needed that at that moment.
Yeah. And that's when I realized that, you know, I'm going to be a Muslim. I want to devote my life to God. And the next day, I took my Shahada. I reverted. And I took on the name Bilal Ashur Muhammad. And ever since then, I've been making efforts to turn my life around. I'm back in college. I'm working on getting a certification and information technology. Hopefully I'll get a degree. And me and my fiance plan on hopefully moving to Turkey in the near future, inshallah.
Inshallah, yeah.
And the moment I entered the mosque, the masjid for the first time, just I felt this sense of peace. I think for the first time in such a super long time, I was fully happy and I was at peace in life. And that's kind of a story. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's beautiful. So, how did it feel when you took your Shahada? Sometimes people have sort of a different sort of feeling, they have kind of an experience. What did it feel like at that moment when you took your Shahada?
I feel like at the time when I was taking it, I was doing a lot of research, and one thing I learned is that Allah, God, will take, if he loves you a lot, he's going to take something away from you, and he's going to choose you, and he's going to test you. And when you're going to test it, that means you know that you're one of the chosen people of Allah. So when I took my Shahada, I felt like the cycle wrapped up and the new journey is about to begin. And I felt a strong sense of emotion. And that's when I started to work on my life and change my life and start doing things. So I felt very emotional.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
Where did you take your Shahada? I know, obviously you planned it. So where did it happen?
I took it at the MCC Mosque in Charlotte. It's known as the Muslim Community Center of Charlotte. I was there with my friend, Easy, that's his nickname, Amin, and the Imam. And obviously, you know, you can't really hug each other because Corona.
I know. That's the downside.
Which is unfortunate. But I was thinking with the Imam. I think his name was John, not his last name. But that's when I took it, and that's when I put a strong peace of mind. And ever since then, I've never missed a service at the mosque.
That's wonderful. Alhamdulillah. So, what were your first encounters with Islam as a Muslim like for you?
Well, I grew up in a family that was very anti-Islam.
Yes.
So my religious faith is kind of hidden from them. Mm-hmm. The only person in my family that wasn't anti-Islam was my grandfather. Because, like I said, his philosophy is he doesn't care what your religion is. Mm-hmm. As long as you're a good person, that's all that matters. So growing up with Islam, I was kind of taught that, you know, Allah is a moon god, which I hear a lot.
I've never heard that word. Okay.
Or as my dad would say, Allah.
Oh, my goodness.
That's so I kind of been taught that, you know, the reason why the Muslims did 9/11 is because they're jealous of our real God, Jesus, and that never trust a Muslim, and that they oppress women, which I never really believed in any of that because, mm-hmm. you know, that's just a biased perspective.
Yeah.
You know, as a matter of fact, Islam was probably one of the first religions that gave women equal rights to men. There's even a chapter in the Quran dedicated to women.
Yes.
So I kind of grew up experiencing just this negative aptitude towards Islam. And as far as me, I never really had a negative connection to it. Mm-hmm. For me, Islam was a religion, and I knew that they worshiped God like we do, but a little bit more differently. And mm-hmm. I never really saw Muslims as bad people.
Sure. I was
very open-minded as a kid.
Wow. Okay. Well, that's interesting.
Yeah.
So, was it difficult for you to start? I mean, some of the you're talking about religion in a different way, you know, worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a different way. Were there anything that was strange or confusing for you as you started on your journey?
Not really. When I started on the journey, I'm currently taking college, like I said, and mm-hmm. and I'm trying to get certification in information technology. Well, one of the classes is a Tawheed class.
Sure.
Which is the Islamic code of oath, how a Muslim mm-hmm. lives life. And when I started learning about that, that's when I realized things make more sense. You
sure.
know? And it wasn't super strict for the sake of being strict. You know, mm-hmm. it was more structured. Mm-hmm. So I didn't find it weird. I kind of found it to be more spiritual than Christianity and Judaism or any other major religion. Because, you know, you pray 5 times a day.
Yes.
The Kaaba.
Sure.
Which the symbolism behind the Kaaba is that this was the first ever house of worship. Like it was mm-hmm. the first ever church, synagogue, mosque, the Kaaba.
Yes.
And
yes.
That's why it's very sacred.
Yes, of course.
So I didn't necessarily feel weirded out by it because mm-hmm. it felt very spiritual. And when I learned more things about it, that's when you know things started to make more sense. Like you know. When I learned about Tawheed, Islamic civilization, things began to make a lot more sense. And I began to connect pieces together. And I kind of devote my life in that kind of aspect. So that's pretty much why, yeah.
So how did your family, do they know that you've become Muslim? I mean, how are they responding to this?
The only members of my family that know I'm Muslim are my two brothers, and they don't really care. They're both atheists.
Uh-huh.
And my cousin, who was more open-minded, and I told her that one day, she's like, oh, cool. And mm-hmm. you know, she wasn't really upset about it. Mm-hmm. The rest of the family, they don't know about it, and I want to be open about it to them, but at the same time, you know, mm-hmm. it's a hard kind of thing.
Sure. Whenever you have to like confront that issue whenever you're ready, or you know, what about your friends and other people in your life?
Oh, they know about it because on Instagram I post Islamic stuff mm-hmm. every so often, and I'm more open about it on my Instagram, most of the social media. Mm-hmm. Not as much on Facebook, besides a few Muslim groups on Facebook that are private. Mm-hmm. Because my family is friends with me on Facebook.
sure.
But the reaction I got when I became more open on Instagram and other social media, most of the friends that I thought I was friends with back at the mm-hmm. church, mm-hmm. the first thing they did was block me and unfriend me. And
oh, really? Wow. Yeah.
But that's okay.
That's too bad.
Yeah, that's okay because when I told me on the Facebook groups and so on and so forth, and I went to the masjid, mm-hmm. I didn't gain friends, but I gained brothers and sisters, which is more important and symbolic than friendship.
So but that's wonderful.
My coworkers, they're happy for me. You know, they're very happy. I work at Starbucks. They're very open minded. Nice.
Yeah.
So they're not upset about it. You know, they're very. So it's been pretty good. Yeah.
So, it sounds like you said your family doesn't know, but your friends are accepting. And so how do you think your family would react if you did finally say something to them about your conversion?
Well, when my pastor found out about the conversion, he wasn't happy about it, which was a very weird kind of situation to be in. This is recent. And, you know, I thought he was open-minded, and when I told him about it, you know, he said that, you know, this is a path of Satan, and, you know, your grandfather would be very upset with you, and he told me that you're an embarrassment to your grandfather, his name is Legacy, and
that's terrible.
Stuff like that, and things said things along the line of, you're just honoring your grandfather, and just a bunch of stuff, which I can't remember, and I told him that, hey, I'm very sorry you feel that way. I understand how you feel. So on and so forth. Maybe we can meet next week and we can talk about it. Where I'm more, at the time I was doing some work, so I couldn't really have any good responses to that. Sure. But as far as my family reacting, they'll probably, chances are, they'll probably just own me because of that.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. And
it's...
It's very hard, and it sounds like your pastor was coming from a place where he was feeling hurt, and he may not have realized that, or you know, have not as much experience with Islam, or realizing that really, you have to, as a Muslim, we believe in Jesus. You know, we believe in the prophets, peace be upon them all, and that really, I feel in a way. Being Muslim has made me a better Christian. So, I mean, he just doesn't know, I think, and perhaps, you know, he's coming from a good place, but then also a place where he is probably feeling a little hurt himself, is my thought. And your family may react in that way initially, but, you know, inshallah, if we keep them in our dua and we pray for them, perhaps they will come to understand how much Islam has made you so much of a better person. Like, we're not different after we've reverted. It's just God has led us to Islam, and we've become, I don't know, more complete in some ways. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
So, but there is a lot of negativity, you're right about that. How was your first Ramadan?
That was interesting. It was during the steering pandemic.
Yeah.
It was kind of a time of self-reflection. Obviously, we couldn't go to the mosque because at the time, the mosque was completely shut off, and all the services were done through the internet.
Yes.
Live streaming. But it was very interesting because that's when I started reading the chapters of the Quran, and I was fasting and so on and so forth, and it gave me a new perspective. Because I think one of the purposes of Ramadan and fasting is to put you in the perspective of people who don't have the luxury of having the things you have, like food and stuff like that, and what they go through on a daily basis.
Sure.
So it kind of put me more down to earth, grounded. Because as a person, I've always had that need to want to help other people. And I think I've been more concerned about other people's emotions. I kind of neglect my own emotions, and that could be a thing or a bad thing, depending on how you see it. But, around that time, kind of, you know, reading more about the Quran, seeing how things connect and how things make more sense, and reading about the Sunnah, the Hadith, it made me more open-minded and more wanting to help people.
That's wonderful.
So with the Ramadan, the first thing I did was I learned to forgive my ex. I didn't send her a message. But I learned to forgive her and move on. Then after Ramadan, just recently, I when I tell people this, I want people to know that I'm not special, I'm not unique, I'm not amazing, I'm not excellent, I'm just a human being that is made of, you know, blood, flesh, and bone, and stuff like that. But I donated, well, actually, there was a bunch of families in Nigeria. One family was in the Mauritius Islands, where this father, he has a kid and wife, converted to Islam. And he lost his job because of it. His boss was a Hindu. They had no money, no food or anything like that. So I gave him $200. And Mauritius Islands, $200 is, it's gold. And he was able to feed his family for about, I think, 6 months, I believe. 5 to 6
That's
months.
Wonderful.
And there was a family, a Muslim family in Ethiopia. They're kind of going through the same thing. No one lost their job. But there's a flood that happened, and the husband is like traveling long distances to look for work. And I was gonna give him $200, which, you know, obviously in Ethiopia that's a lot of money. But the bank I was trying to give money to, they wouldn't allow me to do it because they said, "Well, you don't know this person, so we're not gonna let that happen." And I'm like, "Okay." And I was very heartbroken over that. I was very sad. But inshallah, maybe there is a reason that this happened. Maybe they have to go through their own test, and so on and so forth. The best I can do is make dua and pray for them.
Oh, of course.
Which is what I did.
Yeah, that's a wonderful thing. So
there's a family in Nigeria. Well, not a family, there's a person in Nigeria that I was able to give money to and was able to eat and whatnot.
Sure. It's always wonderful. Alhamdulillah. What was the best advice that anyone gave you when you converted?
The best advice that anyone has given me? I can't really think of anything. I don't think anyone has given me any advices. Most of it is just like long monologues on life lessons. Because one thing about Muslims is that when they give you advice, they tell you a story. And it's like 20-minute story or something. So, but as far as any advices, I can't really think of one that kind of sticks out to me.
Okay. So, any, what advice would you give to new converts or people who are even considering converting? What advice would you give them?
Let me think about that one. The advice I would give them is to just do it. You know, if you know that in your heart that this is right, and you know that this feels like it's right, and that you want to do this, don't even think about questioning yourself. Just do it, you know? Because when you question yourself, that's when you start to have second thoughts. And, you know, either that could be Satan deceiving someone from going to the right path, or the demon trying to see someone. But my best advice for people is, either who's thinking about converting to Islam or wants to convert or revert, ask questions later, do it now. Because your life would be gratefully enhanced by it.
I think, yes, alhamdulillah. So if you could have a gigantic billboard anywhere with anything on it, metaphorically speaking, getting a mission, you know, a message out to millions or billions, what Islamic message would it say and why? It could be a few words or a paragraph. So
probably Allah is in control. And the reason why I would choose that is that I think as human beings, we're very connected to too much to this world. Let me turn my thing off real quick. There we go. Sorry about that. So I think as human beings, I think we're too connected to this world and the present life. We're too connected into the moment. And that could be a good thing or a bad thing. I think a good thing about it is that you can go outside and look at the world around you and be contented with it. But I think we're too caught up on the dread and on the sincerity and the fear of the uncertainty of life.
Sure.
And I think as human beings, or what bad thing happens to you, Allah, God is in control.
Yes.
When something happens to you or gets taken away from you, or where the case may be, it's just know that you have been chosen by God. You will be going through a test, and be sincere, be faithful, and you will pass it. Because no matter what the bad thing is, there's always going to be a good thing that's going to happen after sure, your experience. Sure. So the billboard I put up is Allah is in control.
So with difficulty comes ease.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
So yes, Allah is control, which I think is a good message, because sometimes we get so stuck in the moment that we can't really see the bigger picture. And yeah. So yeah. Is there anything else you would like to add?
Not that I think of. No, I think. I mean, I still suffer from anxiety because after the deaths I went through, obviously that's gonna mentally mess one up, you know.
It does impact you, and I mean, grief isn't something you get over; it's something you just learn to live with those losses, and it's hard.
Yeah, and I'm starting to think. Yeah. Sorry.
No, go ahead.
I'm starting to think that it gave me super severe anxiety that even today I still suffer from, and I'm still trying to go over my anxiety. It's bad. It's very bad. And I'm starting to think that, you know, maybe it gave me PTSD or something, which I'm not 100% sure because I'm not officially diagnosed with it.
Yeah,
but there'll
sure.
be certain things that, certain triggers, because my fear right now is losing people, losing more people.
Sure, of course. Yeah, that makes sense. You lost so many people.
Yeah, and I don't want to lose any more people. So there'll be certain phrases or certain things that bring up that fear of losing someone, and that's when I go full auto, I guess you can say.
Mm-hmm.
So, which I, from research I did, now that's a symptom of PTSD. It's going to remind you of the past. It's going to make you go into full panic mode. And I'm not saying I have it, because I'm not officially diagnosed with it, but there's a chance I might have it.
Sure, sure. No, that makes sense. And perhaps, you know, I know with me, at least my faith has really helped me deal with a lot of those difficulties and those losses. And to remember that with, you know, with this difficulties comes ease, and that too in and of itself is a difficulty and a test for you. And that a sign that God does love you. I know, you know, it's, does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Yeah, there's a quote from the Quran that says that God does not put onto a soul in which it doesn't, in which it cannot bear, or something along those lines. So,
and I pray that Allah makes it easy on you and brings you ease. Well, thank you so much for your interview and for your time. Alhamdulillah and Jazakallah khair. And thank you. And may Allah bless you. And I will keep you in my dua. And I hope you keep me in yours.
Oh, thank you. Mashallah.
Yes. Thank you.
Bro.